Hello everybody, I'm Paolo Abeni, I work for Red Hat, and all after the new fancy stuff you have just seen, I'm going to talk you about something which is both old and ugly, that is MPTCP. The good part is that the agenda here is very short, so you will have still time for lunch. See a little bit about the MPTCP protocol, its working details, and then we will talk a bit about an ongoing effort to upstream it inside the Linux kernel, and why this guy is not going to accept any patches. What is MPTCP? MPTCP is sort of an extension for plain TCP, which allow kind of transport level bonding, meaning that it offers resilience against link failure and also allow for greater perceived per connection speed, that if there are multiple paths between the involved peers. Its usage is almost transparent for user space application. Does not require fancy network topology or equipment, and it can transparently fall back to plain TCP if not both peers talk MPTCP or if there are bits or things in the networking. The MPTCP protocol is described by RFC 6824, which for the version 0 of the protocol, while version 1 is currently under discussion and should be come out soon as RFC 6824bis. So, how does MPTCP work? It basically defines a new TCP option. With type 30, whatever, and several sub options. And it uses several subflow, one or more, for each MPTCP connection. Each subflow can carry part of the MPTCP data stream. The MPTCP option exchange between the peers allow each peer to establish a new subflow and to allow peers to synchronize the MPTCP stream data contents. Each subflow is actually a TCP connection, like a normal, regular TCP connection. The presence of the MPTCP specific option, which is present in most packets, but not necessarily in all, reduces the maximum segment size available for the payload. And if one of the peer does not support the MPTCP extension, it will just ignore that option. And that, as per MPTCP specification, will cause transparent fallback to plain TCP. So one peer can just tentatively trying to open an MPTCP connection and end up with a plain TCP one. The first step for MPTCP transfer is establish a new MPTCP connection, which happens via the MP capable handshake, which is done simultaneously to the three-way handshake at connection opening. The initiator will add an MP capable sub option to the scene. The server will apply in a similar way. At the end of the three-way handshake, if the MP capable handshake is successful, both peers know that each other is able to speak MPTCP, and we have exchanged enough metadata to synchronize the data transfer and to, well, select the initial MPTCP sequence number. You can look at a little bit more detail of what really happens. So the initiator, let's say the client, send the same packet, which carries also the MPTCP MP capable option, which is a variable length option. In the scene, does carry very little information, the protocol version, and that's it. Well, this is for MPTCP version 1, which is the thing that is currently under development and is trying to be upstreamed in the Linux kernel. Version 0 is slightly different. Now, let's focus on version 1. The server should reply with the synact, which should contain an MP capable option, which includes a key for the server, which is a plain 64-bit integer, and will be used later for several things. The three-way handshake is completed with the client teardot, which comprises both the server key that the client has just received and a key for the client itself. Be the teardot a poor hack, we don't have guarantee for its reliable delivery to the other peer. So this information are replied also are present also in the next data packet. So once that the first subflow has been established this way, each peer can add multiple subflows to the same MPTCP connection. Each peer meaning that the servers, for example, can theoretically open a subflow back towards the client using different local address, different remote address, even different server port, even different address family, meaning that a single MPTCP connection can use both IPv4 subflows and IPv6 subflows. That is to make things easier, obviously. Subflows are added using the MP join and shake, which is quite alike the MP capable and shake. It takes part at TCP opening. And uses some information exchanged in the initial MP capable shape to identify the MPTCP connection this new subflow wants to join. Let's see a little more detail. So here there are the two hosts, the same two hosts that were involved in the previous exchange. The host A is using a different local address and is connected to a different remote address. In the initial scene, it includes in the packet this MP join option. As you can see, there is clearly a typo. I'm going to explain why. The MP join includes a token A, that is the typo, it should be token B, because the token is an information derived from the key that the two peers have exchanged in the MP capable shape. Is basically a cryptographic hash. It's part of the cryptographic hash function computed on the key. And the token identifies in unique way this specific MPTCP connection. So sending token B, the client identifies the MPTCP connection which has been created before using KB for the server. And also add a random number. The server replies with CNAC and including an MP join option. This MP join option includes an additional random number and each MAC computed using S key, the concatenation of the two key exchanged in the MP capable exchange, and S message, the concatenation of the two random number just exchanged. this quite fancy, complicated stuff is used to somewhat strongly authenticate. It's a strong one. Strongly authenticate the peers, so the so that no other host could enter this MPTCP connection. And the clients respond with the three-way NSHAC, including RFP join with an HMAC computed in a similar way, just warping the data. And in each step, each peer should validate each data. For example, on the initial scene, the server should verify that the token provided correspond to a known MPTCP connection. On the SYNAC, the client should validate the HMAC provided, and so on. And the MP join and shape is completed with this four hack that accept the data sent by the client on the previous packet. If the MP couple and shake fails at some point, the connection simply fall back to plain TCP. If the MP capable, if the MP join and shake fails at some point, for example, for a bad token or because some middle box strip the option for any reasons, the connection is closed with the, should be closed with the reset. So, once that we have one or more subflow created, we should likely transfer data. And we would like to transfer such data using either of these flows. And they, likely, this data likely refers, for example, to the same video stream. So we must ensure that the data reception is consistent. And how can it work? Works using an additional MPTCP option, which is the DSS that stands for data sequence signals. The data sequence signals contain and specify the mapping between the TCP level sequence number carried by this given packet data and the corresponding MPTCP level sequence number space, because MPTCP level MPTCP is, let's say, an independent sequence number in respect to the each subflows. The DSS options is also used to send back MPTCP level ACK. Since different subflows can use different link with different link speeds and can experience different TCP level transmission, the data sent by the TCP in order of this subflow can be received by the on the other end out of order in respect to the MPTCP sequence number. So the endpoint had to collect the data, reorder that in respect to the TCP MPTCP sequence number, and deliver that way to the user space. The sender itself must keep the data locally till it receives an MPTCP level ACK. So after all this confusion, the handshake per se is quite simple. This should represent DSS mapping. We have two packets belonging to two different substreams. They have likely, for example, the same TCP sequence number, but due to different DSS data sequence number, they map to a different position inside the MPTCP sequence. DSS exchange is quite simple. One peer just send the packet data. It includes the DSS option, which specifies the data sequence number for this data and includes some actual data. The peer must send ACK both on the TCP level and on the MPTCP level, and this ACK can be in different packets with the only requirement that at the MPTCP level ACK should come, not before the TCP level ACK, obviously. So we have seen that both peers could create multiple subflows using different local and remote IP addresses. They can know the IP, these different IP addresses for local configuration, but the protocols, the protocol also offers a way for each peer to notify the other for additional IP addresses, so it could add more subflows towards such address. And this is via just another MPTCP suboption address, which is used to notify the peer of additional IP address. The protocol does not mandate any specific action in response to the reception of an add option, even if likely the expected result is to create additional subflows, at least on the client side. Paired with the added option, there is the remove address option, which notify the peer about the removal, surprise, surprise, of a local IP address, and that should be used by the endpoint to notify link failure, and the and the unavailability of IP binded to the link that just failed. Again, the that handshake is quite simple. One peer could be the server of the client, adds this option to any packet, most likely to a pure ACK packet. The option includes the IP itself, an optional port, which could be the different from the server port, for example, and an identifier, which is used later from the remove address option to identify the address to be deleted. Since this option is usually carried by a pure TCP ACK, and we don't have guarantee of delivery of pure TCP ACK, MPTCP V1 mandate an explicit MPTC level ACK for this option, which is a reply with a similar add option from the other side, including the echo flag and the same addresses information. Oh, it's too early. Okay, so one of the goals of MPTCP is to ensure reliability in respect to link failure. So MPTCP connection survives the reception of a TCP level fin or a TCP level reset. That means that the MPTCP protocol requires an additional way to explicitly close the connection. And this is done again via the DSS option, the data signal, data sequence signal option, including an additional flag, the data fin, which mark the last sequence number carried by this packet as being the last one for this direction. So a data fin closes the MPTCP connection in a single direction, and we need two data fin, one per direction, to completely close the MPTCP connection. As TCP fin, the data fin consumes one single byte in the MPTCP sequence space. This is the DataFin exchange. We have this DSS carrying the DataFin flag. It can carry that also data, but not necessary. And the connection is considered closed when the peer replies with data, hacking the data sequence number corresponding to the data feed. Okay, so this is almost all for protocol specification, at least for what I'm talking today. There are many, many other details in the protocol. There are other options, other MPTCP sub options available. For example, to have a faster shutdown, and also to have more, let's say, verbose notification of handshake failures. The protocol also describes some functional components of a standard MPTCP implementation. We already hinted at the existence. For example, the scheduler is the component in charge of selecting which subflow the protocol should use for sending a specific bunch of data. And the path manager is in charge of creating additional subflows, making decisions about the creation of additional subflows, or notifying the peer about additional IP address to be used for this MPTCP connection. And also the standard have many, let's say, quirk to allow interoperability even with very partial implementation. So is this stuff really new? Not really, because the protocol itself, at least for version 1.0, is 7 years old. On the other side, version 1 is still a draft, so it's very notable. Not many major operating systems offer a core implementation for MPTCP, with the only exception being iOS. And also the upstreaming effort for MPTCP started quite some time ago with the first patches that surfaced back in early 2017. On the other side, the first MPTCP related, strictly related patches had been merged in the next 3 a few weeks ago. And there are only the first few bits. So there is an ongoing effort to have this thing in the Linux kernel. This effort is being done by several companies, including Intel, including Apple, Tesseras, and your truly Red Hat. Now we will see what has been done in the past months and what is currently ongoing, and hopefully what we hope to achieve in a hopefully not too far future. But first, there are a lot of good reasons why there is not yet a working implementation inside the Linux kernel, inside the vanilla Linux kernel, but there are also good reasons why we do want working an upstream implementation. There are effective use cases requested by telcos primarily, and there are several countries, especially Korea, I think, and Brazil, where MPTCP is currently in use. So the first upstream activity that let's go back, sorry. We have said that the MPTCP protocol needs to exchange quite a bit of metadata in several moments in the MP coupled shake, in the MP join shake. That amount of metadata is actually so large that up to a little time ago, there was not enough room inside the Linux kernel socket buffer to carry such amount of metadata. And extending, enlarging, increasing the size of the SK buffer is a no-go because it's an extremely critical data structure for the Linux kernel. Increasing size has several performance implications, which we don't want to eat. In that regard, some time ago, the SKB extension infrastructure has been introduced that allows our kernel subsystem to attach to SKBuf an arbitrary amount of metadata. And such infrastructure is already in use from several subsystems, including Bridge, XForm, NTC, and soon, hopefully, MPTCP. One problem we had while working on the upstreaming of MPTCP is trying to introduce additional behavior on top of TCP. Some time ago, this was not possible as the Linux kernel did not provide any facilities to plug this additional behavior. In late 2017, the ULP infrastructure has been introduced. ULP stands for upper layer protocol, and it allows kernel code to plug additional behavior on top of TCP, replacing, for example, the protocol operation related to a given socket and attaching also additional context to a given socket. In order to satisfy the needs of MPTCP, we had to extend this ULP infrastructure in at least 2 points. One was allowing a listening socket to let the accepted socket inherit the ULP context in a robust way. This required a new ULP helper for the clone operation. And also has been added a protocol diagnostic helper to allow the ULP to push to the user space more protocol specific information. So as said, the upstreaming effort is currently running. The first MPTCP specific patches have been merged early January. The first basic MPTCP implementation has been formally submitted this week. It supports a single flow for now and parsing the basic MPTCP option, but I strongly suggest you to not hold your breath waiting for such patches to be merged. Because the prerequisites took a lot of time. It was quite a simple thing, and we expect this to take still some effort. Anyway, when and if these patches will be merged, Linux will be probably the first operating system to support MPTCP version 1, as iOS currently, for example, supports only V0. Even if it should support soon V1 too. We have a upstreaming project Git repo where we stage the patches we plan to something upstream in such repository. There is a working implementation for the MP join and shake, and that brings as to future plan, which are after getting the pending patches included, to push the MP join support and enough of the MPTCP protocol specification to allow the active backup scenario, which is of some interest for some telco operator. We have most of the code for this feature ready. It's just a matter of getting merged. Pun intended. After that, goal will be to support real concurrent subflows. And this is also something which is strongly encouraged or required by telco, with the use case to deliver ultra high definition content to existing mobile devices using concurrently multiple connection like Wi-Fi and 4G simultaneously. This require quite a bit more functionality because we completed included more advanced path manager and more advanced flow scheduler. And this is pretty much all I have, so I fear I was too fast, indeed. There are a few references to the MPTCP RFC and to the upstreaming project Git repository. And for whoever wants to contribute or just be informed about the development activity, there is the mailing list where much of the discussion take place before official submission. And that's it. So if there are any questions, so the question was if MPTCP V1 is compatible with V0. No, if MPTCP V1 only peer tries to connect to MPTCP V0 only peer, that causes fallback to plain TCP. It will be upgraded soon to V1. We have talked with Apple guy and ensured that. There was another question there?
What is the advantage of MPTCP over QUIC? Why should we use it over QUIC?
Good question. The question was, which are the advantage of MPTCP over QUIC? QUIC is a rising protocol which is built on top of UDP and ensure many things, among them reliable delivery, and also it has support for multipath. One of the advantage of MPTCP, it is completely transparent, or almost completely transparent for user space application, while an user space application needs to be ported to QUIC, because even the basic protocol, let's say, the creation of the socket itself is a bit different. Yes, anyway, QUIC is a competing, sort of also competing protocol for MPTCP. Even QUIC does not have a kernel implementation, and it has only user space implementation. This is sort of a pro or a cons, in, depending on your perspective.
And maybe one follow-up question. Does the routers on the road need to know about MPTCP or is it something completely transparent, especially like regarding NAT?
So the question was if routers need to be aware of MPTCP, especially in regard of network address translation. So the router does not need to know anything about MPTCP. They just need to avoid dropping unknown option, which unfortunately some router do. But that's another topic, I would say. In respect to network address translator, the MPTCP protocol RFC is specific mention to that, and this is why, for example, in the other option there is this ID field, which identify the address independently, let's say that, from the effective IP address value. That said, if you are behind NAT, you still can't connect to the IP address that the MPTCP peer announced. I think that was this.
Yeah, I think you just answered my question. So what's the real world use case for this? You mentioned iOS, that they have the implementation already. So what is this used for?
Beyond the 5G use case, which I must admit, the question was which are real life use case for MPTCP. Beyond the 5G scenario, which I honestly don't know much, sorry about that, ISP are asking for MPTCP specifically to deliver to existing mobile phones ultra high definition contents using the existing link, that is Wi-Fi plus 4G. And also to allow good quality of service, not from a networking point of view, meaning from a human perspective, when using a mobile device, you are in mobility, you are doing, let's say, voice call on top of a data connection on top of Wi-Fi, and you walk outside the access point reachability area, and you switch to 4G connection, and you want this data stream to be still alive. Sorry.
When you have multiple paths, the slowest path will be dominant in setting the overall rate. So is there some algorithm between the receiver and the sender to compensate the...
So the question is, when you have multiple subflows on multiple paths with very different transfer rate, the slowest one can affect badly the overall transfer rate. Are there any scheduler level argument to compensate this? They are not specified by the standard. They are referred as implementation level details. Yes, there is quite a bit of logic behind scheduling data on different subflows. There are congestion control algorithms similar to TCP, but on an above layer. Still, if in the basic scenario where you have a very slow path and a really faster one, It's quite easy to use bot path fully, just looking, for example, at the congestion window on each subflow. The sender has to pick the subflow with the widest widest portion of the congestion window free. I think there was another question.
So I have a question about like security wise. For example, I have a client, I got a malicious MPTCP server and just start sending me an address things with random IPs, like tens of thousands of those. So will my client try to correct all of them and will it try to reconnect them if they are dead?
Need the keys and need the
identification. So, yeah, exactly.
Because I didn't get that part. Yeah. How to secure that the server is authorized to give me this IP to connect to?
So, the question is security related. Let's suppose there is a malicious MPTCP server that send any kind of large amount of other option forcing the client to connect to whatever addresses. The server is somehow legitimated to do that, knowing the being part of the initial MP capable and shake and knowing the token, the keys, the HMAC, etc. The protocol itself does not mandate any compulsory action in response to add address. The expected action is to create a new subflow when you receive an add address, but there are several constraints, some are protocol based, for example, the maximum number of address for subflows is 8-bit, 256. Beyond that, there could be protocol constraints, like we don't support, a protocol implementation could not support more than a certain number of subflows. And beyond that, there are, reasonable safeguards put in place from the implementator themselves. Nobody's planning to let the client open 100 of random connection.
Will it retry? Like if it's a legitimate IP, but it just doesn't work, the connection data is not there. Will it retry it? Like after, or you need to set another address each time?
The question is if the head address if the IP address provided via the head address option does not work, it's not reachable, the connection fail, whatever, what is the expected behavior? I need to double check, but the recommendation from the RFC is to not use a failing path for a reasonable high period of time after the failure itself manifest.
Thank you.
Question? In the case of NATs on the client side, would most clients just not send their additional IP addresses? Like, you know, if you have a mobile connection, most of the time that's NAT before, and if you have a home Wi-Fi connection, that will likely be NAT as well. So would clients depend on the server to send addresses for the multipath aspect?
The question is, if the client is behind NAT and all the addresses it has are behind NAT so that the server can reach it directly, how can the client establish new subflows? Does it depend on server sending additional address? It does not. The client is allowed to establish new subflows according to his own policy. For example, if you have multiple routes towards the same IP address on different links, you can easily establish multiple subflows using the addresses bound to each of these routes. As in the example you did, we can have a route on the Wi-Fi towards the server, route on the 4G towards the server, and we have all the information to establish at least two subflows.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
I set key with multi-path for both, and the IGP is also for multi-paths. So I just want to know if you have ever compared both protocols, SAT and IGP.
So the question is about comparisons between MPTCP and SCTP. I think the guy over there is the more appropriate person to answer this question because I know a little about SCTP. SCTP is a quite complex protocol which allow several features like the reliable delivery of the contents, datagram service, stream service, multiple paths, and so on. As such, SCTP tends to have a quite complex implementation. Performance-wise, tends to be less fast than TCP, for example. To achieve highest bandwidth in the aggregate use case, for example, MPTCP will likely perform better.
Interesting take on that is that by building on top of base TCP itself, we leverage all the existing congestion control and development that's been done in that area. So, I mean, SCTP has gotten a lot of love. I mean, they could build
should I repeat for record sake?
Sure.
Okay, so David correctly noted that TCP is a much more mature protocol with much more testing than SCTP, and with MPTCP we are reusing a lot of TCP feature from congestion control till the basis robustness and performances. And it's very difficult for SCTP to fill the gap towards TCP, even if it's getting a lot of love from several guys. Other questions? Yep.
Yes, the question is from the application. On the API, what does the application need to do to register with that?
Okay, the question is what an application should do to use MPTCP. It actually depends on the specific implementation. The iOS, for the iOS implementation, the application needs to do exactly nothing. There is a system-wide setting, say every TCP connection is actually an MPTCP connection, and that's it. For the upstreaming implementation, we use a slightly different approach. We use a different IP proto number. So the application has to change the IP proto when creating the socket. And that everything is exactly the same. An IBPF program, just to say something, can plug this behavior that is forcing this MPTCP connection instead of MPTCP socket creation in completely transparent way for the application. A question over there? Possible out-of-order delivery of MPTCP data to the peer. So each TCP substream guarantees in sequence delivery for its own content. The problem is that the contents are carried by this upstream in quite independent way. For example, if you have two streams, you send the first 10 bytes on stream one, and the next, and then you send, you want to send, let's say, 10k of bytes on the stream one. And simultaneously to the first 10 bytes on stream one, you send other 10 bytes on stream two. And these 10 bytes are located from MPTCP sequence number 10,000, because you make room for the data you want to send on stream one. Okay, so it may happen that these 10 bytes located far in the future will reach the server much earlier than other data you send on stream one. And then from MPTCP sequence number point of view, will make appear the data out of order. So the TCP protocol has to reconstruct the appropriate sequence using the DSS option, and that's it. Does it answer the question?
From the point of view of the application, will it see?
The application will notice anything. We will receive the data exactly in seconds because the protocol inside the kernel will reorder that as needed. Exactly. Yeah, let's use MPTCP for everything. question over there, sorry.
So if I have, let's assume that we are talking just between two IPs that are now multiple, and I have multiple substreams. Do those substreams are multiplexed over a single connection? Or multiple connections will be created so that there is no blocking of one substream if there is packets dropped in that substream but not in other substreams.
So, first of all, I'm not sure I got completely correct the question. Let me repeat it. The question is, if we have an MPTCP connection on a single path using multiple subflows.
Yes, that multiple subflows.
Yes, that is possible. That's not very useful. Each subflow uses a specific TCP level connection, a five-way tuple, for it. So each subflow will use a different TCP connection. We will have different TCP connection. Other questions? Yep.
Which protocol has been used on top of the MPTCP as field testing?
Okay. The question is which protocols are used on top of MPTCP? The most honest answer I can give is I don't know. I'm betting on HTTP. Other questions?
We have time for the last one question.
Or not.